The next sutta is Sabba Sava Sutta. Actually, Sabba Sava means Sabba Asavala. All the Asavasla. Here it says all the taints. Taints is a translation for Asavasla. To me, Asava means uncontrolled mental outflows. You can also call it defilements. Majjhima Nikaya Sutta number 2. That's how I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living at Savati in Jeta's Grove, Anatha Pindika's park. There he addressed the monks thus, "Monks, noble sir," they replied. The Blessed One said, "Monks, I will teach you a discourse on the restraint of all the taints, restraint of the asavas. Listen and attend closely to what I shall say." "Yes, noble sir," the monks replied. The Blessed One said, "Monks, I say that the destruction of the asavas is for one who knows and sees, not for one who does not know and see. Who knows and sees what? Wise attention and unwise attention." Another translation is careful attention and careless attention. When one attends carelessly, unarisen asavas arise and arisen asavas increase. When one attends carefully or wisely, unarisen asavas do not arise and arisen asavas are abandoned. Monks, there are asavas that should be abandoned by seeing. There are asavas or taints that should be abandoned by restraining. There are asavas that should be abandoned by using. There are asavas that should be abandoned by enduring. There are asavas that should be abandoned by avoiding. There are asavas that should be abandoned by removing. There are asavas that should be abandoned by developing. Stop here for a moment. So from here, this what the Buddha says, that the asavas should be abandoned by various ways, seeing, restraining and all that. So here, what the Buddha is trying to say is that asavas here refers to the defilements. The defilements should be abandoned by various ways. Seeing, restraining, using, enduring, avoiding, removing, developing. What asavas, monks, should be abandoned by seeing? Here, monks, an untaught, ordinary worldling who does not see Aryans, noble ones, and is unskilled and untrained in the Dhamma, who does not see true men, and is unskilled and untrained in the Dhamma, does not understand what things are fit for attention and what things are unfit for attention. Since that is so, he attends to those things unfit for attention, and he does not attend to those things fit for attention. What are the things unfit for attention that he attends to? They are things such that when he attends to them, the unarisen asava of sensual desire arises in him, and the arisen asava of sensual desire increases. The unarisen asava of being arises in him, and the arisen asava of being increases. The unarisen asava of ignorance arises in him, and the arisen asava of ignorance increases. These are the things unfit for attention that he attends to. From here you can see that in this sutta, the asavas refers to defilement of sensual desire, the defilement of being, bhava, being or that I am, and the asava or defilement of ignorance. Sometimes in the suttas, the Buddha mentions four things. When he talks about asava, here he mentions three things. Sometimes one more added is views, having a lot of views. And what are the things fit for attention that he does not attend to? They are things such that when he attends to them, the unarisen asava of sensual desire does not arise in him, and the arisen asava of sensual desire is abandoned. The unarisen asava of being does not arise in him, and the arisen asava of being is abandoned. The unarisen asava of ignorance does not arise in him, and the arisen asava of ignorance is abandoned. These are the things fit for attention that he does not attend to. By attending to things unfit for attention, and by not attending to things fit, by attending to things unfit for attention, and by attending to things fit for attention, both unarisen asavas arise in him, and arisen asavas increase. This is how he attends unwisely or carelessly. Was I in the past? Was I not in the past? What was I in the past? How was I in the past? Having been what did I become in the past? Shall I be in the future? Shall I not be in the future? Which reminds me, a lot of people like to know who they were in their previous life, right? So the Buddha says all this is paying careless attention. What shall I be in the future? How shall I be in the future? Having been what shall I become in the future? Or else he is inwardly perplexed about the present, thus, am I? Am I not? In other words, do I exist? Do I not exist? What am I? How am I? Where has this being come from? Where will it go? When he attends unwisely in this way, one of six views arises in him. The view, self exists for me, arises in him as true and established. Or the view, no self exists for me, arises in him as true and established. Or the view, I perceive self with self, arises in him as true and established. Or the view, I perceive not self with self, arises in him as true and established. Or the view, I perceive self with the not self, arises in him as true and established. Or else he has some such view as this. It is this self of mine that speaks and feels and experiences here and there the result of good and bad karma actions. But this self of mine is permanent, everlasting, eternal, not subject to change, and it will endure as long as eternity. This speculative view, monks, is called the thicket of views, the wilderness of views, the contortion of views, the vacillation of views, the fetter of views. Fettered by the fetter of views, the untaught ordinary worldling is not free from birth, aging and death, from sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief and despair. He is not free from suffering, I say. Monks, a well-taught, noble disciple who sees noble ones and is skilled and trained in their Dhamma, who sees true men and is skilled and trained in their Dhamma, understands what things are fit for attention and what things are unfit for attention. Since that is so, he does not attend to those things unfit for attention, and he attends to those things fit for attention. And what are the things unfit for attention that he does not attend to? They are things such that when he attends to them, the unarisen asava of sensual desire arises in him, and the arisen asava of ignorance increases, etc. These are the things unfit for attention that he does not attend to. And what are the things fit for attention that he attends to? They are the things such that when he attends to them, the unarisen asava of sensual desire of being and of ignorance does not arise in him, and the arisen asavas are abandoned. These are the things fit for attention that he attends to. By not attending to things unfit for attention, and by attending to things fit for attention, unarisen asavas do not arise, and arisen asavas are abandoned. He attends wisely or carefully. This is suffering. He attends wisely. This is the origin of suffering. This is the cessation of suffering. This is the way leading to the cessation of suffering. When he attends wisely in this way, three factors are abandoned in him. Identity view, doubt, and adherence to rules and observances. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by seeing. Stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha is saying, noble disciple, when he pays attention and investigates the four noble truths and he understands them, the three factors, identity view, doubt, and adherence to rules and observances are abandoned in him so that he becomes a sotapanna, first fruit, arya. What asavas, monks, should be abandoned by restraining? Stop here. So just now what the Buddha was saying, there are certain things that we should not pay attention to in the world. And there are certain things that we should pay attention to in the world. Those things that we should not pay attention to are those that have nothing to do with the Dhamma. Those that have to do with the Buddha's Dhamma are the things that we should pay attention to, especially the Four Noble Truths. What asavas, monks, should be abandoned by restraining? Here, a monk, reflecting wisely, abides with the eye faculty restrained, while asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who abides with the eye faculty unrestrained. There are no asavas, vexation or fever in one who abides with the eye faculty restrained. Reflecting wisely, he abides with the ear faculty restrained, with the nose faculty, tongue faculty, body faculty and mind faculty restrained. While asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who abides with the faculties unrestrained, there are no asavas, vexation or fever in one who abides with the faculties restrained. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by restraining. So this second one, the Buddha is saying that we should keep a guard at our six sense doors. Those things that are not proper for us to pay attention to at the six sense doors, we don't pay attention to, like the sight, sound, smell, taste, touch and thoughts. Because if we pay attention to these unbeneficial sense objects, then the asavas or defilements would arise. And number three, what asavas, monks, should be abandoned by using? Here, a monk, reflecting wisely, uses the robe only for protection from cold, for protection from heat, for protection from contact with gadflies, mosquitoes, wind, sun, and creeping things, and only for the purpose of concealing the private parts. Reflecting wisely, he uses alms food, neither for amusement nor for intoxication, nor for the sake of physical beauty and attractiveness, but only for the endurance and continuance of this body, for ending discomfort, and for assisting the holy life. Considering, thus I shall terminate old feelings of hunger without arousing new feelings of greed, and I shall be healthy, blameless, and live in comfort. Reflecting wisely, he uses the resting place only for protection from cold, for protection from heat, for protection from contact with gadflies, mosquitoes, wind, sun, and creeping things, and only for the purpose of warding off the perils of climate and for enjoying retreat. Reflecting wisely, he uses the medicinal requisites only for protection from arisen, afflicting feelings and for the benefit of good health. While asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who does not use the requisites thus, there are no asavas, vexation or fever in one who uses them thus. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by using. Stop here for a while. So here, we use the requisites in a wise way, without being greedy for them, knowing that they only help us so that we can continue to practice the ritual path. If you remember, when we do the chants, we often do this chant, Patisankha Yoni So Chivaram Patisevami. So these are the four chants we did. Then number four, what asavas, monks, should be abandoned by enduring? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, bears cold and heat, hunger and thirst, and contact with gadflies, mosquitoes, wind, the sun, and creeping things. He endures ill-spoken, unwelcome words, and arisen bodily feelings that are painful, racking, sharp, piercing, disagreeable, distressing, and menacing to life. While asavas, vexation, and fever might arise in one who does not endure such things, there are no asavas, vexation, or fever in one who endures them. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by enduring. Stop here for a moment. So, when someone practices the holy path, then unpleasant feelings arise. We should practice patience, forbearance. And if we have the patience and forbearance, and then big problems become small problems. Small problems become no problems. So, that's how we should deal. If we can endure them, we endure. Number five, what asavas, monks, should be abandoned by avoiding? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, avoids a wild elephant, a wild horse, a wild bull, a wild dog, a snake, a stump, a bramble, patch, a chasm, a cliff, a cesspit, a sower. Reflecting wisely, he avoids sitting on unsuitable seats, wandering to unsuitable resorts or places, and associating with bad friends. Since if he were to do so, wise companions in the holy life might suspect him of evil conduct. Well, asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who does not avoid these things. There are no asavas, vexation and fever in one who avoids them. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by avoiding. So this one, we know certain places are not conducive for the spiritual practice. We avoid them, don't go near them. For example, if you want to walk the spiritual path and you're a lay person, and then you don't go near those jolly jolly kakis because they will say, well, formerly our lai used to go to a karaoke and now he doesn't want to go anymore, something wrong with him. And so avoid this type of friends and then you mix with friends who are interested in the spiritual path and then if you for a monk if you want to practice also you don't go and find certain places which are unsuitable. In fact, a place like a cemetery is not recommended by the Buddha. The Buddha says a cemetery is a place with a lot of spirits, unclean spirits, and many of them are crying all the time, so they are very disturbed. So you go to a place, the vibes are no good, but a suitable place. Go to a place which is very peaceful, and there are no snakes and no wild elephants and other animals to disturb you. In fact, during the Buddha's time, if you look in the sutta sometimes, even though some of the monks, they stay in the forest, but actually they stay in a kuti in the forest, you know. They stay in a kuti in the forest. You know. These kutis are built for them to practice. So a lot of people, they don't understand. You have a kuti to practice, you want to go out and sit under the tree. In the Buddha's days, sometimes you look at the suttas like the Maratajanya Sutta. The Mahamoggallana, he was staying in the forest. But he was staying inside a kuti. And then this Mara came to him, into his stomach. So kutis are built for us to practice in the forest. There's no point to go out of the kuti and stay under the tree. If you want to stay under the tree, there's no need for the kuti. Because the kuti is built to provide the most conducive environment for you to practice. If you stay in a kuti with the mosquito netting, there's no mosquitoes. There's no snakes to come and crawl to you. Because I've stayed in the forest before, and sometimes we stay in the open air, and you put your mosquito net, and you put it under your this plastic sheet, sometimes the snake comes. Snakes are trying to enter. I've had this experience. And sometimes you go and set up your mosquito net, your sleeping place, in a place you didn't know there's a ant nest underneath. In the middle of the night, the ants crawl all over you. You have to start moving. So our kutis are very ideal. No need to look for a better place. What asavas monks should be abandoned by removing? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, does not tolerate an arisen thought of sensual desire. He abandons it, removes it, does away with it, and annihilates it. He does not tolerate an arisen thought of ill will. He does not tolerate an arisen thought of cruelty. He does not tolerate arisen evil and unwholesome states. He abandons them, removes them, does away with them, and annihilates them. While asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who does not remove those thoughts, there are no asavas, vexation or fever in one who removes them. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by removing. So here the Buddha says that we should remove unwholesome states of mind, unwholesome thoughts. Don't tolerate them. What asavas monk should be abandoned by developing? Here a monk, reflecting wisely, develops the mindfulness or the recollection enlightenment factor, which is supported by seclusion, dispassion and cessation, and ripens in relinquishment. He develops the investigation of Dhamma, enlightenment factor, the energy enlightenment factor, the delight enlightenment factor, the tranquility enlightenment factor, the concentration enlightenment factor, the equanimity enlightenment factor, which is supported by seclusion, dispassion and cessation, and ripens in relinquishment. While asavas, vexation and fever might arise in one who does not develop these enlightenment factors, there are no asavas, vexation or fever in one who develops them. These are called the asavas that should be abandoned by developing. So this last part, and we practice the bhujangas, the factors of enlightenment. In the process, we develop our mind, and our mind becomes more developed. Then either the asavas, these defilements, arise less often, or if they do arise, then we know how to deal with them. Monks, when for a monk, the asavas that should be abandoned by seeing have been abandoned by seeing. When the asavas that should be abandoned by restraining have been abandoned by restraining. When the asavas that should be abandoned by using have been abandoned by using. When the asavas that should be abandoned by enduring have been abandoned by enduring. When the asavas that should be abandoned by avoiding have been abandoned by avoiding. When the asavas that should be abandoned by removing have been abandoned by removing. When the asavas that should be abandoned by developing have been abandoned by developing, then he is called a monk who dwells restrained with the restraint of all the asavas. He has severe craving, flung off the fetters, and with the complete penetration of conceit, he has made an end of suffering. This is what the Blessed One said. The monks were satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. That's the end of the sutta. So this sutta is telling us how to deal with unwholesome states of mind, defilements, and sometimes called asavas, that arise within us. So that's why I always say that the Buddha's discourses are very practical instructions. They're not all just plain theory. They're very useful. It's not like some of the later teachings, like some of the Mahayana sutras. They like to praise the Bodhisattva and all that. Talk very highly, but it's very difficult to put them into practice. Whereas the Buddha's original discourses are very practical. They give step-by-step instructions on what to do. So if you have the book, later you study the sutta again, then you will know when you have defilements, and defilements arise, how you should deal with them. So to recapitulate, one is by seeing clearly. Seeing clearly means paying attention to the things that you should pay attention to, and not pay attention to those things that should be avoided. Then another one is by restraining your sixth sense faculties, not to see too much, not to hear too much, smell too much, etc. And then the asavas to be abandoned by using the requisites to get rid of uncomfortable feelings. We don't have enough of the requisites, then you will have a lot of disturbance. Then asavas to be abandoned by enduring. Sometimes uncomfortable feelings arise, sickness and all this. And there's nothing we can do except to endure it. And then asavas to be abandoned by avoiding. Avoiding a place that is not suitable for you. Avoiding associates or friends who are not suitable for you. Not suitable for your cultivation of the holy life and all that. And then asavas to be abandoned by removing unwholesome states of mind that arise. For this, we have to constantly look into our mind. And then by developing asavas, by developing our mind, practice the what is taught by the Buddha and the Noble Eightfold Path, keeping sila, samadhi, and panya, studying the suttas. So in that way we develop our mind and we can handle the asavas much better. So I think I'll stop here for today. Anything to discuss?
What's the meaning of extension and endure?
Vexation means something that vexes you, annoys you, disturbs you. Fever means the mind is so disturbed, is so agitated, very agitated.
Another question, this one regarding the power to be moved.
Firstly, you need to see clearly. A lot of people, the mind is not developed. So when anger arises, they cannot see clearly because the hindrances are very strong. So if you practice a spiritual path, we meditate to clear the mind, of the hindrances. So this to remove the ill will, unless you have a developed mind, it's very difficult. If your mind is strong, then you know that the Buddha says ill will will lead to a lot of unhappy consequences. So seeing clearly, immediately, your mind just stops there. But if your mind is not strong enough, you cannot stop there. You cannot see clearly, you cannot stop all this. That's why you need to develop the mind, otherwise it's difficult to practice. You should know. You don't have to ask me. You know it for yourself.
Yeah, that's why I'm asking for any proof, because sometimes you know it, you're angry, the ill will, but it's just that you cannot solve the mind.
It's not only this problem, it's also this, like for example, mindfulness meditation. Nowadays, all the Vipassana meditations have to do with mindfulness. But mindfulness by itself is not enough. When unwholesome states arise, then you know, but you have no control over your mind. That's why the Buddha says this right concentration is the four jhanas. When your mind is strong, then anything you know that you should do, immediately you have strength of mind to do it. But if you don't have the strength of mind, you are mindful, you know, and yet the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
One more question. This one, Bhante was mentioning that Buddha wise in monks to avoid the cemetery communication. And reading the book on the forest type of monk, and they seem to have a continuity of the flesh to go to the cemetery there. What is the
thought? A monk can go to the cemetery if he wants to contemplate on the corpse. Because sometimes there may be a corpse there for him to contemplate. But generally, I remember seeing, reading somewhere, the Buddha says, cemetery is an unclean place. A lot of wailing spirits and all that, crying spirits and all that. So you go there, I don't think it's a suitable place. The vibes are no good.
What is the
when we say avijja, ignorance, generally it means ignorance of the Dhamma, ignorance of the Four Noble Truths. And when you study the Dhamma, you start to chip away this ignorance. As you know more and more Dhamma, your knowledge increases and your ignorance decreases. But then, if like in the beginning, even though you studied the suttas, If you have not developed the jhanas, then your mind is still has a lot of greed, hatred, and delusion. So the greed, hatred, and delusion can only reduce if you have a very focused mind will reduce the greed, hatred, and delusion. And then when you reduce the greed, hatred, and delusion together with the knowledge of the Dhamma, in other words, samatha is the meditation that reduces your defilements of greed, hatred, and delusion. And then vipassana is that contemplation of the Dhamma, hearing of the Dhamma, that gives you the knowledge. Combination of the two will totally eliminate your greed, hatred, and delusion. So it is because of ignorance that you have greed, hatred, and delusion. And this delusion is not seeing things as they really are. And delusion, the Buddha says, is something that is very difficult to eliminate, because when you are deluded, you don't know that you are deluded. So for example, somebody who studies the Dhamma, if his mind is full of defilements, say like he doesn't meditate, then he may be deluded that by studying the suttas that he already has some attainment, then he start using the suttas to criticize other people, but he doesn't see his own faults because he's deluded. So you have to, the theory itself is not enough. You have to meditate to get rid of the defilements. So the avijja, ignorance, is the lack of Dhamma knowledge. But the delusion is something personal, that individual. Because the Buddha says to see things as they really are, yatta bhuta jnana dasana, you need a concentrated mind. So if a monk does not have a concentrated mind, he cannot see the contradictions between the sutta and the abhidhamma, and the sutta and the commentaries, and the nikayas and the later books and all these things. Cannot see clearly. The delusion is due to the undeveloped mind, so it's deluded. So all that studying of the books and all that doesn't clear away his defilements, doesn't get rid of the delusion. So he needs to meditate and attain one-pointedness of mind. Okay, shall we stop here?